In today's video mini lecture, I'm going to be talking about Manhwa and their contemporary iteration, Webtoons.
Manhwa are called manhwa in China as well, manga in Japan, and gurumjik in the DPRK. And then today I'm also going to talk a little bit about the subgenre of girls' comics, which is called sunjang manhwa. So we can divide the history of manhwa into four main periods. The first one is from 1909 to 1945, so that's during the Japanese colonial period, and manhwa was, of course, distrusted as being a potential site of subversive ideas. But from 1945 to 1970, we really see the genre take off and develop in Korea. Comic-only magazines such as Manhwa Seige emerged, and then there was enough support that later they started to publish comic books. From 1958, Korea developed this rental shop, kind of like libraries, except for you're paying a rental fee for manhwa. And the success of these rental shops, these manhwa bang, further promoted publication of manhwa. The period from 1971 to 1999 is considered to be the renaissance of manhwa. And this is when we have adult comics emerging, genres of humor and romance, and even sci-fi. And then in the 1980s, we really saw the emergence of graphic novels. And representative of that is something like Lee Hyun-sae's Gongpoi Wein Gudan. And there were, of course, a lot of popular authors that I've written up there on the screen if you want to check it out. From 2000 to the present, we get an entirely new era of manhwa. That's when we have a combination of new media and the infrastructure of the internet that has meant the emergence of webtoons. And this has firmly become established as the main genre in manhwa at this point. It's also new educational delivery method for children's information. In this era, the main artists have been people like Yoon Tae-ho, which is why most of the reading for this class focuses on Yoon Tae-ho. There are more than 130 different publishers involved, with three main manhwa publishers right now. Those three main publishers are publishing about 50% of all of the stories. I wanted to talk a little about the existence of sunjang manhwa because I think the fact that the Korean industry developed an entire subgenre of manhwa just specifically for female audiences says something about Korea. Now, sometimes these stories were drawn by men, especially in the early years, but they primarily had female lead characters, topics of interest to female readers, and they became very popular after the Korean War. Although, like other manhwa, they experienced a lot of censorship in the 1970s, they began to take off again, starting with the success of Candy Candy in Korea, which actually is part of an era of ripping off Japanese manhwa, but that's a completely different story. So the 1980s was really the most significant era for sunjang manhwa, and a lot of new artists debuted in this time period. These new artists elaborated narratives, scrutinized histories, described human nature, discussed contradictions in reality, and they dealt with serious themes such as revolution, war, religion, and identity. And these were really enthusiastically welcomed by Korean comics fans compared to the Japanese counterparts that had been selling sort of on the black market before that. The internet took off quite rapidly in Korea, and from the late 1990s, artists were distributing their work on private blogs and on websites, but they still got most of their money from publishing books and selling merchandise. So the actual term webtoon was first used in 2000. The difference between webtoons and classic manhwa is that many artists realized that they didn't have to constrain themselves to the sort of rules of paper anymore. So anyway, from 2002, major web portals competitively started offering Webtoons for free so that they could get more traffic and they could generate active users on their platforms. The big players, of course, were Dalem and Naver. They always are. Anyway, these Webtoons had really original stories, and they developed solid fan bases and had really great visual images. And this attracted filmmakers and TV producers. And so what has ended up happening is that Webtoons have become one of the biggest sources of stories that are transitioned, transmedia stories that become remade as films and dramas and whatnot. The growth has been explosive, from 163 Webtoons in 2010 to 1,817 coming out in 2016. Cumulatively, by July of 2017, there were almost 6,000 Webtoons that had been released. And the market, in terms of the financial side of things, is also growing at a tremendous rate. With more than 61 Webtoon platforms, and these platforms having more than 203 million monthly user visits, you can understand why all of the different platforms want to get involved. But there's still problems for the international expansion of Webtoons. Piracy, translation, regulation, and even just the technological infrastructure that exists with Korea's fast internet and maybe not elsewhere are some of the problems that need to be overcome.